everybody. What's up? I'm Sarah the Rebel.
And I'm Misfits Tamara.
And this is Woman Up Podcast. Yes. Brr, 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 brr. Brr, brr, brr. If you're new here, this is a podcast where crazy cat ladies talk about geeky stuff like superhero movies and anything else we decide is geeky today.
And then we're going to run down our favorite nerdy news as we do. And from the week, or maybe before the week, we don't know.
I think it was mostly this week.
It's mostly this week, but sometimes we just like to, you know,
YOLO.
Change it up, whatever. It's cool. And then we do our chick picks, and then we're going to dive into our main topic.
Yes, and for returning fans, welcome back. If you're listening to us on allgames.com or iTunes, hello future people. You are probably just as future as anybody else, now that I think about it, since we don't do live shows anymore. We need a new term for you instead of future people. Leave some comments of what you would like to be called instead of future people.
Erica Badu's.
Oh my god, can we call them Erica Badu's? Never mind, don't leave any comments, we have decided. Oh look, today we have a guest!
Oh, hi guest!
Hi!
This is GK Bose, she's going to tell you a little bit about herself. Who are you? What are you doing on my couch?
Thank you, well, I'm so excited to be here. Thank you for having me. I'm GK Bose, I am a voice actress based in Los Angeles, and you may have heard me on Minecraft and Naruto, a lot of Disney stuff. Oh, video games. What do you call it?
You were Laura in Street Fighter.
Thank
right?
you. Yes, Laura in Street Fighter. Felicia in Marvel vs. Capcom. What else? Oh, all kinds of stuff. Oh, I just narrated the Disney Moana audiobook. So excited!
In my face, excitement.
Oh, yeah. It was such an honor to do that, and so yeah, you can hear me on Pac-12 networks and selling you McDonald's and Walmart and like other commercials and stuff like that.
That's really really cool. Yeah. So fun fact: the guy who let you into the house, Cap Wan, you guys know him. Mains Laura in Street Fighter. That's the main Woo! Character you play. So I was like, the voice actress is coming. He's like, fix my hair. So today we are going to be talking about the best of 2016. And we're going to be sharing some of our picks. And of course, if you disagree with us, argue with us, yell at us, call us names involving chickens only. You can call me any name you want, but you have to incorporate chickens into it for it to be allowed.
Or fisher people in various languages.
Oh yes, pescador. So now it's time for Newsflash. While we're newsflashing, I'm also going to turn on a fan, because good lord, it got hot in here.
Well, it's just, you know, us.
We are very hot. It's not anyone's fault. It's just how it is sometimes.
We were born this way.
Maybe it's Maybelline. So the first piece of news that has everyone talking is the Spider-Man Homecoming trailer came out. Did you guys see it?
Yes. There's actually also an international version, which is slightly different. I don't think it has any additional footage that I recall. Maybe a little bit, but it's tonally a little bit different. But, hey, look at all those brown kids up in there.
It is true.
Yeah.
I love that other people were having the same conflict as I was. Like, yeah. I don't want another Spider-Man movie. I'm good.
Yeah.
I've seen this man over and over. Let's move on. Let's have a Ms. Marvel movie.
But look at all these brown kids.
Oh, yay. But then also, on the other hand, we always get to be the sidekicks and the background characters. Cool. I'm so conflicted.
Yeah. And the thing that a lot of people are like, okay, so this is Genki, right? From Miles Morales' best friend in this thing. Because it's like very obvious. Like it's Genki. Like it's like, it's Genki. But they're like, no, his name is Ned Leeds, apparently. And I'm like, yeah, but it's Genki, though.
Interesting. They do that sometimes. They blend different lines together, create characters based on that.
And this is very heavily Ultimate Spider-Man. So I get it, but also that's conflict of everyone who's like, why don't they just make a Miles Morales movie and then you're going to take his best friend and put him in this movie?
Yeah, his best friend was good enough for you, but Miles was not.
Though I do understand from a building a character standpoint that in the MCU, you need to have Peter first.
Yeah.
I appreciate that, but also just have a movie with Andrew Garfield and kill him halfway through and put in Miles.
That's what I said. If you kill him, I'll go watch it.
Mm-hmm. That's a good idea.
Make it interesting, up the scale.
But, you know, but it looked enjoyable. I think there is, much like DC has a Batman problem and that they're over-reliant on him, Marvel has a Spider-Man issue in that they can't keep him out of high school for that long. So every time they do a thing, like I find Peter more interesting when he's an adult, personally, because it's like different, more conflict, things like that. Like, I think that's really interesting, especially like given the arc of he used to be a kid superhero and now he's an adult. But like whenever they get to that point where he's kind of adultish, you're like, oh, no, I'm gonna pull him back.
Right, and it's like, if you're gonna make me watch this over and over and over again, like Batman and that Pearls in the alley scene, like you could just at this point make it different, make it interesting, make it Miles or make it Kamala Khan. Like they if you want to tell a high school story, they have really interesting high school stories going on right now. It didn't need to be Spider-Man. You could put the Spider-Man name on there to get butts in the seats. You know how it goes. Star Wars had people complaining about women and black characters and still busted down those blockbuster numbers, so it's not something you have to be afraid of.
Yeah. Get that money. Get that sweet diversity money.
Did you have any thoughts on the trailer before?
Well, one of the things, since you said the diversity thing, it's interesting because I believe that we have been tricked into thinking that, you know, diversity is this gift that we've been given, and all it is just another commodity. Like, it's just another selling point.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, you know, and I was, for the same reason, very conflicted about the trailer. Right. But, you know, at least it's happening.
Right.
So,
yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's like, oh, look at all his best friends who are of color. See, look at the diversity. It's like, oh, I know what you're doing and it's working.
Yeah,
right?
I see through you, but I got you.
Right? It's like the election, but we don't have to talk about that. But it's the same thing. It's just like we're being tricked, but I kind of like it.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, it's just, yeah, right. we like the abuse.
Some sort of symbiotic.
Right?
Yes.
And it's like, and it is entirely reflective in how it should have always been. Having majority people of color in his
life.
Come on, man. He's in New York.
He is not going to have a cute little redheaded white girl as his neighbor. I'm like, that's just...
What?
It is statistically improbable. Yes, statistically improbable. Oh, and one last thing. I like how they keep calling Zendaya's character Michelle. And I'm like, oh, y'all know that's Mary Jane. I was like, yeah, Michelle. I'm like, she's Mary Jane. It's like, it's
like
just...
no, she has all, she's a different character. We're all like,
sure, yes, gotcha. Yes, Mary Jane. Mm-hmm. Just like not Genki. Yes,
again,
great.
Y'all want to be scared. It's fine.
It's fine.
It's
just,
okay.
Embrace it. Just do it. Oh, and they had all these little videos of like Zendaya, the girl who plays Liz Allen, whose name I can't remember, and the main guy, like, learning dances, and they have these, and they would, like, do little, like, vines of them on their Twitter, and it's the cutest thing.
It's actually very cute.
And they already had me before that trailer came out. Aww. Like, I realize this now, and I'm like, they're so cute. Yeah, because that kid was, he was in Billy Elliot. He was in one of the Billy Elliot musicals.
Like he has training.
Yeah,
like,
actual training.
Very cool.
Yeah. So
the videos are really cute.
They're so cute, and I was like,
I gotta check those out.
I knew I was in danger already. I was like, you guys are so cute together. Aww. Damn it.
Well, it's like Stranger Things. I never watched it, but like I have a love for the cast despite never watching because I watch
so
all their other videos.
You
like you guys
watch
are adorable.
It. They are adorable. They are adorable.
It's on the list.
Yes. I started it, and then my internet started acting funky.
Oh. Well, it's easy to watch it, but there's only 8.
God damn it, Time Warner! If you're listening, stop fucking up. We try to watch stuff.
I know.
Right?
Yeah.
Time Warner.
That's not my life.
The devil. So, moving on to another trailer that came out, The Mummy Reboot.
Oh, yes.
As we all take a moment.
All right, let's just, first of all, I got to fight over this a few times. I'm tired of fighting about it. So I'm going to tell you this, if you come to me on Twitter and your opinion is different than my opinion, I don't care. I'm not going to debate it with you because your opinion is wrong. Anyway, so... The Mummy Reboot, it's got Tom Cruise, it's got the lady from Star Trek Beyond, so what is it, Sophia Betababalupala, Louise? I don't, listen, she's awesome,
she's
from Algeria, her dad was a jazz musician, I know a lot about her, except her last
except her name.
she is the mummy, and Russell Crowe is Dr. Jekyll.
I forgot about that too.
Right, and the trailer looks like an action movie. Like if I didn't tell you it was The Mummy, you would just think it was what's his series that he does?
Mission
Impossible.
Yeah.
It's a lot of bright sunlight flying through buildings, giant cities being destroyed. It's very superhero-esque, which personally does not sit well with me because In addition to just being a fan of the very the first remake of The Mummy, the one that starred Brendan Fraser, I'm also a fan of, if you're going to make a horror series based on horror monsters, you should have some horror elements.
Right.
And this is where I got into a fight with people. They were like, oh, The Mummy of Brendan Fraser wasn't horror. Actually, it was. You're wrong. It's listed as horror anywhere you look. It's a fantasy horror movie.
Yeah.
Hmm. It had comedy elements. But if you actually go back and watch the movie, the pacing of the movie, the slow reveal of the monster, the creepy bugs, the ancient tome, the lighting.
Dude getting his
eyeballs ripped out.
That was scary.
Yeah. It was scary. Yeah. If you go back and watch The Mummy, it's a scary movie.
Yeah.
It's funny, but Freddy Krueger was fucking funny. We don't call that movie a comedy.
Right.
Anyway, so I got a lot of arguments. People were like, I just think it's action. I think you guys are just remembering The Mummy 2 and 3.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes. Were not as good.
Yeah.
As
no, they weren't. No, they weren't.
Fuck that kid. I'm sorry. Excuse me.
He really did.
I hated that kid so much. I'm... That's a whole other thing. I hate
Wait, which one? The one in 2 or 3?
In
both.
2.
Because he was awful in 2 and then he was an adult in 3.
Even worse in 3.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
I don't like bratty kids.
Mom,
as a...
Mom,
yeah.
I'm mom.
No. I hate bratty kids
like
as
bratty
a plot
either.
Point. It's the worst thing.
No.
It is. Why don't any movies just let kids just
be like,
kids?
Or,
there's a whole range of kids.
Yeah, there are kids who are well-behaved. There are kids who are jerks. There are kids who are very smart. Their kids are a little slow. It's fine.
Right.
Just they don't all have to be jerks. Anyway.
Right.
Yes,
I agree.
Yeah,
my dad's gonna kick your butt. Oh, okay. Cool. This is a mummy you're talking to.
Yeah. It's a magical creature.
He should have just spanked the shit out of him. That would have given me a lot more enjoyment.
It's a giant water hand.
Oh, okay, you know, I'm not gonna kill you, but waka, waka, waka.
You all know your place. Yeah, the thing about the trailer to me was it seems like it was cut to be a Tom Cruise movie and
yes.
not a mummy movie.
Yes.
And it might be one of those cases where the trailer is misleading because that happens a lot. They present it in one way and it ends up being a different thing.
Right.
I think that they don't know how to market it yet.
Hmm.
And I think that as Tom Cruise, as a marquee, I mean, listen...
People are going to go watch it.
People are going
to
go watch
it. See it.
Like,
yeah.
Tom Cruise is running and stuff is exploding.
Behind him.
It's a yeah. guaranteed moneymaker in that respect. And they will at least make back their profits. So I think that's because that's what they were focusing on. And not so much as the monster. And I don't know whether they weren't showing the mummy more because they don't want to
spoil it. Yeah.
But, it could at least be nighttime.
Yeah, who's the studio putting this on? I can't remember.
It's Universal.
It's Universal,
yeah,
okay.
Because it's part of, they've been playing.
Right.
Monster.
That's right, that's
shared
right.
Shared universe.
Right.
The Avengers,
yeah.
but with monsters, I
yeah.
guess.
Exactly. I mean, I think, and it seems like they're trying, you know, I think Universal is, you know, they have the right idea,
mm-hmm.
you know, in bringing this franchise back, because they do, they have all of those amazing monsters mm-hmm. that they could be doing something with, and I think... You know, it's on one hand, it's a little refreshing to see them kind of go up against all the superhero
yeah.
world. You know, your DC and your Marvel. Now we have these monsters, and I think they've been forgotten
yeah.
over the last several years. And the only time we think about them is around Halloween.
Yeah.
Sometimes not even then.
I never.
Because we're too busy looking for our Iron Man costumes.
Right.
But yeah, no, I think it's yeah. When I first saw the trailer, I didn't. Realize what it was for.
Yeah.
I thought it was for another Tom Cruise Mission Impossible film.
Yeah. That's what it looked like.
It's exactly what it looked like. And then there's this woman whose eyes are like turning into four eyes.
Yeah.
And then I was like, wait, what? What's happening?
You killed all those brown people on the plane.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I'll see you.
As usual. Now, the one thing we can say is the actress who's playing the mummy, she is that person whose name I can't remember from Star Trek Beyond,
right.
Sophia. And like I said, you know, she is from North Africa, so she is from the area. That's
yeah.
a big step
That's
forward.
That's huge.
But like,
they still picked the like lightest person they could find, and they whitened her up a bit. If you've seen her other
yeah,
movies,
she
was in Kingsman, the Brown Lady.
That's
yeah.
right.
Yeah.
yeah, they keep putting her in white makeup. It's interesting.
Yeah.
Funny. Anyway, but what is more interesting to me is originally, apparently, the mummy was going to be a guy,
oh.
and he. Was apparently going to look like Ivan Ooze because when the writers saw X-Men Apocalypse, he was like,
right.
oh no, this is my exact mummy design. Now we gotta pause real quick.
Mm.
Y'all think that Egyptian men were purple and wore little woot-woot things? Like, what made this happen to two different white men's brains that they were like, this is what I'm going to do? Know, they were going to make him purple. They were like, oh, he's skin pigmentation. That's right. Why he was bullied. Are you an idiot?
In defense of Marvel, Apocalypse is just this weird creature of purple with blue lips, and he's like millennia old. So they have an actual background of it. I'm not saying he should have been purple to begin with, but
I wouldn't have made him purple in live. Y'all didn't want to keep the X-Men outfits.
Yeah.
Then you don't get to keep purple people.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think like initially when he was introduced, you didn't know what his deal was. You thought maybe he was an alien.
Right, yeah.
And then it was like, no, he's just like this weird mutant with different, looking all weird and junk and millennia old and turning other people purple. He turned, Angel turned purple.
Purple people, yeah. I'm just saying, y'all want to keep some elements and drop other purples. Ridiculous element to keep. That's all I'm
trying
to say.
Blue is fine. No purple.
Yes. So anywho, it's true. Blue appears naturally in nature. Purple, so rare. You gotta hug a snail and get all the juice out to even get some purple popping off. Anywho, so originally this character was going to be all purple, and that was the part of the reason for the othering of the mummy. Now, I'm sorry, you ain't never seen no daggone Paytons. You couldn't have picked another color. Okay, it's fine. I'm just very angry. So they were like, well, why don't we make him a woman? And you know what? Kudos to you for doing that.
Yeah.
Good job. I hope you're listening to me and belittle you. But good job on picking a woman. Yes. And I kind of like the spider eye thing.
Yeah.
I thought it was cool. Yeah, it was amazing.
It's different.
We'll see. Because then also, like, symbols, it looks like. Also
yeah, and it looks like she's got the writing all over her.
So that should be, that'll be interesting to see how that works. I mean, like, it looks like there could be interesting things in it. It's just not, it's not what I was expecting, I guess.
I think this is something where if you told me in the 90s or the early 2000s, hey, we're going to make a shared monster universe.
Yeah.
With, like, the Van Helsings and all the, like, leather.
God, that
would have
been
like,
so cool.
Yeah, it probably would have been, like, kind of a fun, campy thing I'd probably be all about. But in today's gritty, realistic age, I'm kind of like,
Yeah, I think maybe that's what it is. I think the gritty realism of it, that they always want to bring to things and make it not fun. I don't know.
Right? Like, you could, the mummy? Sure, make that gritty and dark. Dark, 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 dark. It's a mummy.
Right.
It's all about death. No, we're going to blow up some buildings.
Oh, yeah, well, and I think also, too, it's the age thing that they want to go after. They want to go after younger viewers.
Yeah.
They want to go after, those. They want to get them now while they're young, so that they're going to be fans, as they age, like Marvel and DC.
Yeah. Right.
So I think they're going after,
right?
Yeah. Well, yeah, no, but I think they're going after that younger audience, so they can get those lifelong fans, because those monster fans from back in the day, the baby boomers, they're all in their 60s, 70s now, and they don't have anybody, like, no millennials who
are familiar
familiar with the Frankenstein and the mummy and the Wolfman and all that stuff.
I mean, they did try, like, they had the Wolfman with Benicio del Toro.
It was just,
bleh. Which was, and then the Van Helsing, bless Hugh Jackman.
Van Helsing did its best.
Bad. They were bad. And they weren't targeted at the right audience.
No. The cloud with the single tear. We were in the theater. We were like,
"What?" I loved Van Helsing. Everyone's wrong. Van Helsing's wonderful. Anyway, moving on.
It has its place. Go with your heart.
I will always go with my heart.
And speaking of comic book stuff, so apparently, and it's not surprising to me somehow, they're going to push back Justice League 2 for a Batman solo flick. And so, what also is happening in there? Zack Snyder is making some movie he's had in development for like a decade.
Yeah, another one?
In the middle of this. That has nothing to do with superheroes or anything. So, would you like to hear my conspiracy theory on this?
Yes, yes!
So, this is the price we pay to get Snyder out of the DC universe.
Oh.
This is what I think is happening.
Mm.
I think they're giving him this film because they have lessened his control over everything based on everybody's kind of negative, or most people's negative reactions to the world building. And they're putting this Batman solo flick on the fast track because that's what DC does. They lean on Batman a lot. And also because based on all the buzz from Batman v Superman, people responded very positively towards Ben Affleck.
Mm-hmm.
And, from the extended version, they responded better to the script. than initially, because it's like a good half an hour of stuff that actually would make the movie make sense. So that's my conspiracy theory, that this is the way that they're getting him out.
I hope you're right. I really do. You guys may have noticed, Tamara and I's voices are also a little hoarse.
Yeah.
We had an office holiday party last night.
Yeah.
We did a lot of yelling.
Yes, we did.
Ooh. And DJ, you suck so bad. So our voices are just a little shy. I figured I should mention it.
I'm just saying that you don't skip the Ludaverse on any song.
Why?
Like,
and then they skip the part in the, I can't remember which song it is, but the part where it drops, where the beat drops
yeah.
for dancing explicitly.
Yes.
For what? Dancing.
Yeah, they kept cutting that weird place.
Where was like, this holiday party?
The Edison, which really lovely.
I love the Edison.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
If you're into that sort of thing, walking down a lot of stairs.
Yeah,
There's a lot of stairs. And if you're trying to look cute in heels, it's not fun.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I was like halfway down the stairs and I was like, there's still more stairs.
We open the door and look at the stairs. We're like,
Our entire group was just salty face coming down the stairs. Like,
no.
We high fived when we got to the bottom.
Exactly, yeah, exactly. Like,
congratulated
we survived.
No
one tumbled down anything. It was great.
Would have been a better entrance now that I
know. Yeah. If you like Willy Wonka, Anyways, yes. So yeah, that's my conspiracy theory about that. Does anyone else have any thoughts about the pushing?
I think you hit it on the nose, personally. Whenever they notice like something's trending and something's good, they're now rearranging things around that.
Yeah. So hopefully Wonder Woman will do well. And I hope it does.
I'm probably just going to buy a ticket and not go see it.
Oh, no!
Just like, here, let me help the box office.
Take my money.
But I don't want to be hurt.
I have so little of my soul left. This is the part that will kill me.
Oh no!
Right. This, all you guys can watch. If you guys tell me it's good, I'll go watch it. I'll buy another ticket.
It'll be fine. Everything's gonna be fine.
I need to protect myself.
It'll be okay.
It's all gonna be fine. Okay, so now that we have that, let's get to our
chick facts. I must have the last chick. So my chick pick, I will post the link, but Aaron Bagwell is the director of Dreamgirl film, along with Kamal Minhas, and the founder of Feminist Wednesdays. That's a podcast. And the Dreamgirl film is apparently kind of documenting a lot of really awesome women doing really cool things. And I just learned about her this week. I asked my friends if they had any suggestions for chick picks. And so I am now following her and Kamal, and I'm interested to see what else comes of that, and I recommend that you check them out as well and support their work.
Good stuff. Mine is a podcast called Cinema and Noir, and it's a bunch of lovely ladies of color talking about film. And so, I follow the Film Fatale, is that what it is?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're Twitter besties. Not really besties, but I'm going to say that we're besties. I'm besties with Twitter people.
It counts.
I love Twitter.
So there's, really, really smart women, and you should check it out.
Podcasts are awesome. What do you guys do? I mean, oh my gosh.
Oh yeah, we're a podcast.
Right? you guys are amazing. I bow down to you. I'm so honored to be here today. It's great seeing, seeing podcasts and, women of color doing podcasts and talking about geeky stuff. It's just, that makes my heart so big and
warm. We're just so happy
fuzzy.
That you came.
I know.
Oh, no.
We're happy to have you.
Yes.
Oh, now we're going to have a feel fest.
Feelings.
Okay.
All
right. But I think, so many great, great things that women are doing out there. And, especially in this world. One of my favorites is Denise Vasquez. She's a comedian. She's Puerto Rican. She's hilarious. And she does a show where she has just all women, all women comedians and stuff. And it's just that female perspective. We need it.
Yes.
We need it. We do. We do. And it's fantastic, especially today.
Yes. We need humor and we need joy.
We need humor and, definitely. And it's just, and just the different ethnic voices that are out there.
Yeah, definitely. Awesome. We're going to check her out, too.
Yeah, she's awesome.
So, now it is time for our main topic.
Main topic.
So as we mentioned earlier, our main topic is the best of 2016. Of course, these are all of our opinions, which we will back up with our opinions, backing up these opinions. Yes. It's all completely relative. And your opinion, I know I made fun of you earlier, but the truth is your opinion is worth just as much as our opinions. Opinions are worth nothing. So feel free to get in the comments, tweet at us, and let us know what your picks are for any of these things. Now let me get my very important papers out. Because we did a lot of in-depth research for this. Because you forget how long a year is.
Yeah.
You're right. You're like, oh my God, that was this year.
Right. It's like, oh, February.
Oh, yeah.
I remember February.
That was a thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yes, definitely. So we're going to start off with the big guns. Best movie of 2016. Before we tell you our picks, let me just say there's a lot of great movies that came out this year.
Absolutely.
Deadpool.
Yes.
Civil War. Keanu Reeves. Star Trek Beyond. Zootopia. Moana. Mm-hmm. Rogue One is about to come out. We've been hashtag blessed. Yeah. The geek gods have blessed us.
Yes.
So... Moana, for me, was not in the running because I haven't seen it.
Yeah.
And, of course, Rogue One is not in the running because we haven't seen it.
Yeah.
So, future. I'm going to move those out of the pile. Don't get mad. You can get mad. You can tell us it's fine.
It's okay.
It's fine.
So, what was your pick for best movie?
I'm going to go with Zootopia. And I think it's it's that thing that when animation is at its best, it can be entertaining, but also, you know, like kind of make you learn about things and introspective, or you know, who hasn't been a little child who had dreams, you know, like so I think that, like, and then very also teaching you lessons. I know I have a friend who always I'm always like, look, here's my thing. I feel like that if you're gonna have a thing for kids, especially, that you should be able to glean something positive out of it,
mm-hmm.
or even to a degree, to a point, I feel like comedy also has to have a point. To, you know, past a certain, like, if you're just doing pratfalls or whatever, okay, sure. But then after a certain point, I feel like you have to have some sort of POV and you have to have a point. And she disagrees with me, but she's wrong. And so,
remember what we said, opinions.
Yeah, and so, yeah, so I feel like Zootopia is like a great mash of like animation at its best and really like giving you the feels.
All those feels. Yeah. Do you have a pick for best movie 2016?
I do. And this movie did not get any. I mean, it's starting now just to get a little bit of press because it's in the running to be considered for an Academy Award nomination. It's the highest grossing.
It's so gross.
It's not gross. It's amazing. It's the highest grossing animated film of all time in China.
Oh.
It beat out the Despicable Me. No, the Minions. It beat out the Minions.
Yeah.
It beat out Kung Fu Panda the weekend it came out. And it's called Monkey King, Hero is Back.
Mm-hmm.
It is a beautiful, beautiful film. You know, and for audiences who aren't familiar with Chinese history, you know, and all the immortals and all the gods and everything. I mean, the Monkey King, he's kind of the... It's funny because actor James Hong is in it. And he jokes that the Monkey King should be the god of America because he's just like boisterous and just says what he
means. Makes a lot of sense. It's probably why we like Goku so much.
Yeah.
But he kind of compared him to a certain orange person. You know, a very hairy orange person. But, you know, James Hong is hilarious. But anyway, this movie, go find it. Go see it. It's gorgeous. It's beautiful. The voice acting is superb. You know, it's dubbed, but you can't really tell.
Yeah.
And it stars an amazing little boy named Cannon Kurowski.
Mm-hmm.
And it was his first animated film. And he also happened to be my son. He's amazing. And, but yeah, no, the film is great. Go see it.
Awesome. Awesome. I do love me some Monkey King. And you should go research it because I made a Goku reference for a very specific reason.
Yeah.
So this was so hard for me, you guys. Because at least four of the movies that came out this year were like favorite movies for me. Like, I liked Keanu because it was so relatable. How is this relatable? It was about gangsters and getting a kidnapped. I don't know. And yet I related to it so hard. Captain America Civil War. Tying all those things together, like, telling that story, it making, picking up all the pieces that Ultron fucking dropped and being like, here, no, you still love this.
No, it's fine.
Sorry about that, guys.
Everything's fine.
And then Star Trek Beyond, which took another franchise that was starting to teeter and
mm-hmm.
picked it back up and was like, no, look, there's a reason you love this.
Yeah.
So this was very difficult, but I'm going to go with Deadpool, which I know is an unusual choice, but Deadpool, I think, is the movie that showed Hollywood folks you can actually do this the right way.
Yeah.
You can have a dirty adult superhero movie, and people will love it and go see it anyway.
It is technically the best X-Men movie they've ever made.
Yes. Oh, God, I am, yes.
Yeah, that's the exact Colossus.
So good.
It's hopefully going to up, I know this sounds terrible, some of the more adult aspects of superhero movies. They've said it's already influenced some of that in the upcoming movies. So I'm, you know, as an adult fan of comics and everything, I'm very excited about that. If we're taking source material to movie, I think it was the most impressive. Because Deadpool, I would never agree with you that there could be a successful Deadpool movie. It's such a wacky, weird comic character, and they did it in a way that felt completely authentic. So for me, it was just the most impressive. So that's why I've got to pick it for my best movie.
And I think the cast, I mean, you know, the
Ryan Reynolds. Yes. I ain't never been attracted to that man before today, but go.
Right? I mean, he was, I've been a fan of him since, you know, Van Wilder, and he's so funny, and just this self-depreciating guy, and you're just like, oh my God, you're adorable, and you're hilarious, and he was perfect. Mm-hmm. Perfect. I can't imagine a better Deadpool.
Right. Yeah. And don't get me started on the positive representations of sex in that movie.
Oh my God. So good.
And I do hope that the lesson that they learn is, if you're true to the character, you will have success, as opposed to, let's put curse words in it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, because that's, like, honestly, it's not just that you can do adult things for adult people, but you can be true to a character. If you are true to a character, it will resonate with audiences. And, you know, yeah. I don't mind gritty stuff, so long as the thing that you're making is supposed to be gritty.
Yeah, I wouldn't even call that movie gritty.
No, it wasn't.
No,
I'm just saying, like, that, and that was you're a Wonder Woman correspondent.
Right, and that's another thing that set it apart from other superhero movies, is it didn't try to be the dark and gritty version of Deadpool.
That was a dig at Man of Steel that I did.
Oh,
I guess. Okay, sorry. I didn't throw that out. It wasn't specifically. Sorry, I have very strong Superman feelings. All right, we're gonna not do that, because it's supposed to be a happy, reflective
thing. Anytime you mention Superman movies, I'm immediately not happy, so you've ruined it all.
I'm sorry.
Best TV show of 2016.
That is a hard one. There is a lot of good shows. We were talking about it before, and it's like, you know, Atlanta and Insecure and. Mm-hmm. I am going to go, however, with Luke Cage.
Mm.
It broke Netflix.
Yep.
Yes.
For a little bit, because people were so excited to stream it. And from I feel like it was a really interesting way of doing a character study. It wasn't just like superhero stuff, but it was really like looking at these characters and actually giving you a reason for what they were doing. And like you seeing the thing. And it was like the best use of hubris that I've seen in a really long time. It's like really actually showing how that works, how your own, you know, self-import can lead to your own to your downfall. So and it's packed full of just great actors. So
yes,
it's very difficult to not pick that. And but also there's another bunch of other shows, but I'm going with Luke Cage, because Luke Cage.
This one was hard for me. Stranger Things was so good. I loved it so much. Our whole family loved it. You know, and I loved it because my kids got to watch it, and they loved it, and my kids are, you know, they're gamers too, and they appreciated that, I'm trying to be, I'm a good mom, and I'm educating my children about the 80s stuff, because the 80s was so great, so they knew about all that stuff, and so they really enjoyed it, but I have to go with Black Mirror. Black Mirror was so good. I just demolished all three seasons. I couldn't get enough. My husband's is a techie, geeky guy, so he does that stuff for a living. Like he could, you know, kill somebody with a furnace if he wanted to, just by hacking into their system. But not that he would. But I'm like, he's
amazing.
But just all the stuff that's, I mean, it's almost not science fiction because we are getting there. And one of my favorite episodes was San Junipero, or well, I think they called San Junipero or something, but San Junipero is how you're supposed to say it. But anyway, that was my favorite episode, and just, you know, because it was, first of all, It was an interracial lesbian relationship between these two beautiful women, and they got to like live happily ever after in this cyber world, and it was just like, ah! So yeah, so my favorite is Black Mirror, and I loved how each episode just, it's so well cast.
Yes.
The acting was just exquisite in every episode. So yeah, I'm gushing, but it was so good.
We like it. So yes, I did hear a lot of great things about Black Mirror. So like Stranger Things and Westworld are shows that I'm hearing a lot about. They're on my list. You know who I am. If somebody doesn't sit me in front of a TV and put it on for me, I'm probably not gonna watch it. I did just want to give a shout out to how wonderfully diverse TV was this year. We had Atlanta, Insecure, Queen Sugar, Luke Cage, and black. TV was so good. And there's something for everybody, which don't normally get, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, we had the one show, and that was it. So, this was also really hard for me. Since you picked Luke Cage, yes. I was struggling between Atlanta and Luke Cage. I'm going to then pick Atlanta. Guys, I've told you a million times, if you have not listened to me and watched at least one episode, you are a fool. Atlanta is so good. In fact, Aaron came into the bedroom this morning and was like, hey, so I really need to catch you up on the last two episodes of Atlanta, because like, why is this show so relatable? It has invisible cars, but like, I feel like this was us. Like, he was at a party and he was feeling this way, and she was at the party and she was feeling this way, and you and I have literally been at parties. I felt it. And this is the magic of Atlanta. A lot of people are like, what? After you watch a few episodes, you're like, what is this show kind of about? Right? Because it's kind of just a show about people. What is the driving plot? What is the story? And Childish Gambino, what's his real name again? Danny Glover, there we go. I'm like, I just know you by your rap name, homie. He was like, the thought behind Atlanta is, could we help someone understand what it's like to be black? Which is an interesting concept. So essentially what they're doing is they're creating little vignettes of moments and feelings to try and like express to an audience that might not be familiar with it certain things. But if you are at all familiar with black culture, you feel like you're watching yourself in some of the characters. And that's what, like, you know, Cap Wong came in and said, and what I feel every time I watch it, I'm like, I'm that chick. I've been in that bed. I've had these same conversations. Like, you feel such a connection to the characters, and it's so funny and relatable, and yet there's also wacky, weird stuff. Like, Justin Bieber is black, and like I said, there was an invisible car. So it's just, I love the show so much. You guys should definitely check it out. Cool. All right, moving on to gaming.
Burr, burr, burr. Burr,
burr, burr. My Jamaican air horn is broken. Burr. 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 I'm so sad. So we've split this up into best AAA game, best indie game, and then our thoughts on which console won the war this year. These are wars.
You know, there's a lot of great games that came out. We were having conversations about, like, what do you pick? Because there's at least six things in every category that could very easily win, depending on how the wind blows. I'm going to go with Overwatch, because it is a freaking phenomenon. Like, you can't deny, like, everybody is, there's a guy at work who's like, yeah, I just played, like, 400 hours of Overwatch this week.
Yeah, like, there's a couple guys that
there's a couple guys in there who are like, oh, okay. It's like, yeah, I'm, like, ranked, like, in the top 10 of all, you know, characters, you know, of all people who play this character, and we're like, makes sense.
It's ubiquitous. See it everywhere. Even if you don't play the game, you know the characters in OY. Yeah. You know at least three of them.
Yeah.
And I think one of the things that helps it the most is that they are so smart with the, like, they have these animated shorts about each character, and that's so smart, and they're really well done. So, like, they introduce a new character. I can't remember.
Sombra,
yeah. That Sombra thing, like, when that hit, and the boop.
It was a huge deal. Right.
Yeah.
And I think of Overwatch characters as kind of the Hello Kitty phenomenon, mm-hmm. where they give you enough about the character that you get a sense of them.
Yeah.
But most of the things you feel about the character, you're inferring, you're putting into them. Mm-hmm. And that's what all the fan art is. It's like, oh, well, I just imagine that they're this. They are not as fleshed out as your average character. But that was the good thing, is they let people be able to create their own stories. So, as much as people complain when it was picked for Game of the Year for the Video Game Awards this year, at the Game Awards, I I think the Video Game Awards is different from the Game Awards. Anyway.
I always get confused.
The point is, you cannot deny that this game has taken over the gaming industry and perhaps has created some new trends and changes that we will see in future games. Did you have any opinions on video games?
I agree with you. Overwatch was great. I was so happy to see that Street Fighter got Best Action Game. That was super exciting to see. But yeah, there's a lot of really good ones. And I mean, the gaming industry is weird right now, though.
You know, yes,
it's weird. There's a lot of weird stuff.
Like to speak of Street Fighter, it's a game that when it launched was completely broken.
Right.
And that's becoming the norm
of
so many games.
Yeah.
We'll patch it later.
Yeah. Let's just get it out. You know, people will complain, but they always complain. It's okay. We'll just fix it.
And if you're a big enough franchise,
it's okay. You can get away with it.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
So I'll list some of the other games that came out this year for anyone needing to know. Battlefield 1, mm-hmm. Last Guardian,
yeah.
Dishonored, Doom, Titanfall 2, mm-hmm. Final Fantasy 15, Uncharted 4, and Watch Dogs 2. Mafia 3.
Metal Gear Solid 5.
Yep.
Yeah.
Phantom Pain. Watch Dogs 2 and Mafia 3 get a shout-out for me for having black protagonists. Battlefield 1 gets a shout-out for mostly advertising a black main character. Mm. Although they did change it in some later advertisements,
did
which
they?
I thought was interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, they had the exact same scene, but suddenly it was a white person in that person's role.
Yeah.
I thought that was very interesting.
A little sketchy.
So this was hard for me because, as you guys know, I've kind of fallen down the indie game well, so I'll have more to say on the indie game choice. As far as gameplay, to me, Uncharted 4 and Titanfall 2 is very hard for me to choose. Uncharted ended a story in a way that made a lot of people happy.
Mm.
It was this beautiful world, completely immersive gameplay, almost like watching a movie. But I think I'm going to go with Titanfall 2 because it was so surprising. As you guys know, I like Titanfall, but I didn't play it that much because it kind of sucked, and they did not have a single-player game. They didn't have a single-player campaign. Titanfall 2 came out with an amazing single-player campaign, like, above average, interesting, pulls you into the story, even though the main character kind of sucks, bless his heart. I keep pretending it's just a lady, because, you think of it the last name anyway. So I'm going to go with Titanfall 2 because they listened to the fans and they actually gave us what we wanted. And nobody's talking about them because nobody expected it to be good. So it wasn't on anyone's radar to really give it the attention it needed. So here you go. You got attention from me. Respawn, you did a good thing. All right, on to indie games. Now, I don't know if you two are gamers as much as I am. So if you don't have an answer.
Well, I got my PS4. So I'm going back into it because most of the time I've been playing at people's houses. So when I'm playing at people's houses, it's like, oh, we're going to get together to play X or Z. I did the Hunters of the Moon that we
Moon
played.
Hunters,
yes, sorry.
Hunters of the Moon.
Hunters of the Moon.
That's the same in Spanish.
Yeah, I always want to make it like the fancier names than they are sometimes. But yeah, I liked Moon Hunters when we played that. It was actually pretty cool. I liked that there was a lot of branches that you could do, a lot of different endings. And you could play it a lot with friends, like in a row, like... I like that, so I'm going to go with Moon Hunter.
Did I tell you I eventually got the good ending?
Oh, you did?
Yeah. I had to play this game all the way through about 10 times.
Oh, no.
And then I finally just had to look it up. There was a big clue that's missing, and I needed to look online to find that clue. So I don't blame myself, but it's definitely a difficult kind of old school throwback game.
Yeah.
I love it.
That's awesome. No, I didn't really, I love indie games.
Mm-hmm.
I love indie game companies. So I try to, support them also. I don't have a favorite.
Right.
But yeah, there were a lot of good ones this year.
There were, definitely. So we'll talk about a not-so-good one, No Man's Sky. a lot of hype and then kind of failed. Stardew Valley, which everyone is addicted to. I'm not playing it because I see it. I'm like, oh no, I'll farm my whole life away. I'll just be here and I'll never leave. Headlander, Banner Saga 2... For me, this was between Headlander and Banner Saga 2. As you guys know, No Man's Sky came out. People asked me to play it. I played it. I was actually avoiding No Man's Sky to play Headlander because it was so fun. Headlander, for anyone who didn't see my stream, is a platformer. It's kind of like the other games I like, Guacamelee, stuff that kind of a Metroidvania style where as you unlock things, you unlock more secrets and go back. It's very, very fun. Banner Saga 2 is a sequel to Banner Saga, which is an amazing game. Strategy, RPG elements made by some folks who worked on Dragon Age originally. So, I think I'm going to go with Headlander because Banner Saga 2, its one failing was it doesn't feel like complete games. It feels like I'm getting pieces of a complete game, yeah. Which makes sense. It is an indie studio, but I feel there is a more elegant way to handle it, and they leave a little too much mystery and unanswered problems. So Headlander is my pick because it was surprising. It's dirty. Like, they make a lot of jokes. So you're a head flying around sucking onto bodies, and so they make a lot of sucking jokes.
Oh, no.
It's just, oh, it's so good. Full of innuendo.
Nice.
Do not let your children play. Well, they can play it. They won't get it.
Right. Okay. Good to know.
But they may start quoting things that you're like, don't say that. It means something you don't know. Yeah. So, yeah, moving on to animated. Animated series.
Sorry, the console.
My voice is going further.
Oh,
further.
Console.
Oh, sorry,
console.
Sorry.
Yeah, the console.
Yes, yes. Do you guys have an opinion on who won the console war this year?
I feel like the X-Bone, if you will, the Xbox One, the backwards compatibility of it, even if they don't sell as many units, I feel like it offers a little bit more in a way that PlayStation kind of doesn't. But, I mean, PlayStation always sells a lot. It's just but I do think Xbox is an underrated kind of thing. I mean, it has its issues, but what doesn't?
Right.
So I'm Xbox.
All right, we got a little vote for Xbox.
Yeah, I think, you know, we have, so, you know, I've got three boys in the house, you know, my husband and my two sons. So they go through them all, and the Xbox seems to be the winner every single time.
Awesome.
Just, I guess, the versatility, yeah. And, you know, they can talk to it.
It is cool walking in the house and being like, Xbox, turn on.
Exactly.
You walk in the house, you say, PlayStation, turn on. PlayStation says, did you just ask me to make you a coffee? And you're like,
nope.
I said something rude the other day. I don't remember. Something like, yeah, I'll sex you. Like, you know, back-talking somebody. And PlayStation was like, what was that? And I was like, PlayStation listening to you. And I was like, no, PlayStation, no. So I'm going to pick the PlayStation 4. Not because I'm a Sony fangirl, but it is crushing it in sales, especially with the announcement of the new stuff. Mm-hmm. And PlayStation Experience showed that the PlayStation has a much, much bigger pool of exclusive titles,
yes,
than the Xbox
this
One
is
has.
True.
This is true.
So for me, I'm going to say that was my winner for this year. I think, you know, from the start, it upped its ante. And it was like, we're going to keep our lead over Xbox, which it probably doesn't even deserve, but it has. I do wish I could tell my PlayStation to do things. Could you pause this movie? No?
Mm-hmm.
All right, cool. Thanks. It's fine. It's got games.
It's all right.
All right, animated series.
Yeah, this is also another hard one because there have been some really good animated things coming out. I am going to go with Gravity Falls. Which ended this year. I think I'm a sucker for
cornrows and manicured toes.
Sure, but also I like when there are things about siblings getting along, especially when they're kids. And I think, I mean, in addition to all of the wackadoo, like really smart, like stuff that they talked about in the first couple episodes, coming back in the last ones, it's just like it was a great completion to a series. It answered a lot of questions, and it was about, you know, friendship between siblings, which I think is not a thing that gets played up enough.
They're always fighting.
And so I just think it was weird and great, and it made kids, you know, think about things and decode the stuff at the end, and people, like, have all these fan theories, and I, you know, I appreciated that. So, Gravity Falls, finger guns.
Yay. Sorry, my stomach's growling if you're hearing weird noises. That's my stomach growling. I apologize. There were so many really good ones. I mean, I'm a big anime fan, so I loved, you know, all of the anime stuff that was out. Durarara was such a great show. And but I have to give it up for Chris Nee, who is the creator of Doc McStuffins.
Mm-hmm.
Her show is so inclusive, so culturally inclusive, and just it. I love, you know, they have amputee characters and like characters with cancer, and you know, just all the different ethnicities that she has on the show, and the writing is so good, and she kind of reminds me of Shonda Rhimes a little bit. She's like the Shonda Rhimes of animation. Nice. And just the things that she puts in her, that she writes into the show. And she had the first lady on her show. It was so cool.
Yeah.
So Chris Knees, Doc McStuffins gets my vote for best animated series.
It's a good show.
It's very great.
Good show. Yeah.
This was so hard for me because I do watch anime and I'm like, do I pick an anime that I love? But to be honest, a lot of the animes that I love did not have great seasons this year in particular. So I am going to say Dragon Ball Super. Even though it came out a little earlier, it's now starting to get the dub. So I'm counting it as 2016.
Mm-hmm.
I think that they really... Somebody had a talk with them and was like, you know, this is what people loved about Dragon Ball and Dragon Ball Z. So can you do these things that people love? Can you completely fan service this show? And they were like, sure, why not? And so there's a part of it that's like, I'm being fan service too. Like, they had an episode with O'Reilly, the android that Akira Toriyama created for his first thing, and doesn't make any sense in the show whatsoever. But they were like, you probably will love this Tumblr. And we were all like, yes, yes, give us more. We're terrible people. So, you know, they've combined the fighting of Dragon Ball Z with the humor and irreverence of Dragon Ball. And it's working really well for me.
Shout out to Goku for being a terrible parent.
He's the worst. I don't understand you people like Goku. He's terrible. He even had a choice. He was like, no, you're not dying. There's no one to kill. You don't have the world to save. Spend some time with your family. He's like, well, I'm really bored. I'd rather be training. Like, you missed their whole lives, sir. What a jerk. It's okay. You're not fit to be a father anyway. Let Piccolo raise your damn kids.
Oh, my God.
Anyway, Piccolo, father of the year.
Mm-hmm.
So, best voice actor or actress? No, we had to exclude you because you're here.
It's okay.
Yeah,
it's just
not okay.
Fair.
No, it's not fair. So we talked about, there's a lot of great people, obviously.
It's very hard to choose.
I went with Kimberly Brooks for Voltron.
I love her.
She's, I mean, like, little brown princess.
Yeah, she's the mom on Doc McStuffins.
And she's very prolific. She did a bunch of different stuff, too.
She was Ashley in Mass Effect.
Yes. Yeah, so, you know, not a terrible choice. But that, I just feel like there's a lot of things that I was looking for Voltron that were not exactly where I wanted to go, but
yes.
Everybody's relationships and the voice actors were one of the brighter spots, and it definitely made me keep watching it, and I just really liked her as the princess. So.
Yeah, she's really the reason I kept watching Voltron.
Aww.
Her and Pidge.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Aw, Pidge. So that's what I went. And then, are we doing a male actor?
Well, let's do female first,
yes.
And then we'll go through.
Okay.
Female first. Gosh, this was also and there's so many. You know, there's so many wonderful, wonderful voice actresses out there. Kari Wahlgren's probably always going to be my hero at the top of my list, and also because she's a very dear friend. I love you, Kari. And she was very instrumental in helping me getting my career off the ground.
Awesome.
And you know,
look at that, women help a women.
Yeah, and you know, and that's one of the things I love about the voiceover industry is that. It's, you know, we all help each other. It really is, you know, especially the women. Like, there's not a lot of catty competitiveness going on. I mean, it exists and everything, but Kari, for me, she really, in the beginning of my career, took me under her wing, and she introduced me to all the people she knew, and every single one of them has hired me, and, you know, and then, you know, here she is just with her own amazing career, and everything she does is just spectacular. That woman can do no wrong. Kari.
Really awesome. So actually, I had Kimberly Brooks as well.
Yeah.
Like I said, Voltron didn't get my pick for best animated show because it had a lot of problems. But I watched that whole thing because it, you know, the characters were great. And that, you know, that's often a problem with animated shows is you usually are more into anything but the voice acting. You know, but this time around, the voice acting was top notch. All right, let's go into the buoys.
Yes. This one's difficult as well because there's a lot of, like, you know, Nolan North, we're talking about Uncharted 4. And there's so many good actors and actresses. I'm going to stick with the Voltron thing, but I'm going to go with Josh Keaton because I feel like he puts in a lot of good work anyway overall, and that was another aspect of one of my favorite people in the show. So,
And he makes a lot of dad jokes on Twitter. Because they're like, space, and people will call him Space Dad, and he'll respond.
Aww.
It's adorable.
That is adorable.
Yeah, so that's why. Shout out to Space Dad.
I'm going to go with Keith David.
Oh, I love Keith David.
Classic
Keith. Love that man's voice in everything that he is in. what was he? Wait, there was something specifically this year that I loved him in, but my brain said, fuck you, Sarah. Now I can't remember what it was.
In the meantime, while she's thinking, I'm also going to give a shout out to Patrick Warburton and Clancy Brown.
Yes.
They are also perennial favorites.
I had a hard time choosing between Keith David and Patrick Warburton.
Yeah.
I love him. They're both so good. How can you choose? Ugh. All right. You know what? My brain does not want to remember what I like Keith David in this year. That's fine.
That's fine.
In the past, I've liked him in Mass Effect, in various Army commercials.
Yeah, shout out to Gargoyles.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Everything he's been in, his resonant voice is immediately recognizable. And he's on Twitter now, just being like somebody's uncle, just on there all the time. And it makes me smile.
Aw. That's awesome. Well, this one was easy for me. Cannon Krowski is... he's so good. Even if he wasn't my child, I would still think he's amazing. He's very talented. I mean, he just the Monkey King film. He's in a series called Little People Toys.
Oh, yeah.
He plays Eddie, and he also voices a lot of the toys. So if you ever go into Toys R Us or whatever, see Little People Toys, you can press the button, you'll hear his voice.
Oh.
He did Dying Light. He's a little kid. Obviously a little kid voice in that game. I do my best to stay out of his career. Mm-hmm. I want him to have his own experience. Mm-hmm. I'm very kind of anti-stage mom-ish. Because, he is... I wish I had a quarter of this child's talent. No, he's so ridiculously talented. So keep an eye out for Cannon Krowski, or an ear out, because you're going to hear him a lot more and a lot more stuff, and you're going to see him as well on the big screen. He's got a movie tonight. On Ion, Christmas, what they call it? Christmas with the Andersons.
Oh,
and
that's awesome.
Look for him in like some Disney Nickelodeon stuff.
So how did he get into voice acting then? Like, how did you know that's what he wanted to do?
Well, I waited. It's hard being in this industry,
mm-hmm.
first of all. And a lot of, I'm just going to say it, ignorant parents think, because their kid acts out a lot, he should be in show business. And a lot of the times you have these parents who are doing it for themselves and living vicariously through
mm-hmm.
their children, who move out here, and make their kids go to auditions and things like that. And that was just not, thank God we live in LA, and that was just not what I wanted for my children. My older son did a little thing for Disney, and he liked it at first, but then he's like, this is not for me. And I was like, fine, don't do it. And then Cannon, he begged. I waited for him to, because, kids change their minds.
Yeah,
he begged for me to get him an agent. I waited until he was about 8 years old, and
mm-hmm.
I was like, all right, you understand, because he's also very lazy.
Mm-hmm.
You know this about yourself, Cannon. he doesn't want to, study his scripts and stuff, so I have to, kid, if this is what you want to do, you have to go to class,
mm-hmm.
you have to study your scripts, you have to study your craft. And he was always just very dramatic, some people are like that. When he out of the womb, like, okay, this kid, he's either gonna need to be he's either gonna need to be really smart or really funny and be an actor. So, I mean, he's both, thank goodness. He's very smart and he's very funny. But that's just kind of who he is, and we saw that in him. And but again, I wanted to make sure that's really what he wanted to do. So after he begged for about 3 years, got him an agent. He booked the first audition he went on.
Oh.
And, he's just been doing his thing ever since.
That's so awesome.
Yeah, and he loves on camera. Like, for me, I'm just a voiceover person. Well, I'm not just a voiceover person, but I don't...
You prefer it.
I prefer it. Like, I don't actively seek out on-camera things.
Mm-hmm.
But for a kid, like that, he loves it. He loves, look at me, I'm on camera. But he also, he's such a good voice actor, too, because he's so dramatic, and he brings all those natural things into the booth.
Yeah, that's
and,
crazy.
Yeah, no, so he's my favorite male voice actor.
Oh, I wish I was her favorite. All right. So we covered voice. Let's go into just general actor and actress. There should be a word for them. On screen?
Actors. On screen.
On screen. Yeah. Actor, actress. Okay.
I am going slightly out of... There's a lot of great actors and doing a lot of great work. You can name check a bunch, but I'm going under the radar a little bit. And this is Leslie Ann Brandt, who is on Lucifer. She plays Mazikeen.
I love her!
Yeah. So, and this season in particular, there's a lot of interesting things going on in which Maze is, like, having friends and, like, exploring everyday life. And there is... She's... I can't stress enough how good a work she's doing. There's this one episode where she, like, kind of, like, has a friend, and then it kind of gets weird. And just the look on her face when she kind of, like, realizes it's not... Like, there's being weird. Like, it's so good. It's so good. She's so good on the show. She's my favorite on the show. So, shout out to Leslie Ann Brandt.
Very good. I don't know. There are so many wonderful, wonderful actresses. Oh, gosh. I'm really, I'm kind of in love with, and I'm terrible for not even remembering her name. I just call her Wonder Woman. Like, I'm kind of, like, I just, thank you.
Yes, okay. Like, what's wonderful.
Yeah, right now, right? I think, I'm just excited to see what the world is going to do with her.
Yeah.
And how they're going to receive her and treat her, in this industry now that she's, going to blow up and everything. So, I guess she's not my favorite, but like she does have my attention, and I kind of want to see what people are going to do with her.
I liked how she was like posting like pictures of her flexing and balancing on stage, like as she's training for the role. Yes.
Yeah.
More of this.
Yeah, it was kind of cool.
Wow.
Alfre Woodard.
Yeah.
Oh,
well,
I love her.
First of all, she's just great in everything she's ever been in.
Yes.
But second of all, Luke Cage. I did not know I was going to fall in love with Mariah. I had no idea I was going to fall so hard for Mariah. There's so many moments of silence, too. One of the reasons why Luke Cage is a masterpiece, and I don't understand anyone who says that they were bored by that film, there are so many moments that are allowed to be quiet and acted instead of spoken and told and told to you. Mom, my voice is getting worse. I'm sorry, guys. So she's just phenomenal. In everything she's ever in, but I'm gonna pick her for this year because of Luke Cage.
So good. Are we doing that?
Also, she's so sexy.
Oh yeah,
she is. No, she really is.
I think she's like 60 years old.
Right?
Yeah. Life goals.
Yes.
Yeah. Are we doing actors too?
Yeah.
Separately? Okay.
We could ignore the men.
I know,
right?
I know.
Yeah.
There's a lot of different things. Like, that's really hard. I do have to give a shout out to James Marsden on Westworld.
He's great.
He's always really good and stuff. And like, honestly, I don't understand how he's not a major star, because he's a really good actor and he's real pretty.
But he's in a lot of stuff.
He is in a lot of stuff, but he does like, based on his talent, like he should be Tom Cruise level. Like I feel like that's a thing that like he totally could have. I mean, maybe he doesn't want that. Maybe he's, but anyways. So he's really good on Westworld, as is everything else he's in. But I cannot pronounce his name. He's Cottonmouth on Luke Cage, and I'm not even gonna try.
Mahershala Ali.
Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah. Because again, like when I was talking about hubris and sort of the fact, like he plays that so well, and I think it's a part that definitely could have gone very wrong in the wrong hands. So that's one more. Yeah.
He is my pick
as
well. And Moonlight, I haven't seen it yet, but I'm going to see it because of him.
Yeah.
He, again, someone who used his quirks more even than his words to make this character. Yeah. The smile he would do after something terrible would happen. Oh, my God.
So
I was
good.
Like, why am I in love with this villain?
Yeah.
I'm a bad person. He's on brand.
Yeah, it's on
brand. I think he's great. I've seen him in other stuff before, too.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't necessarily remember where it was, but I was familiar with him before he came to this role. And he's just one of those just good actors.
Yeah.
Mm. And he's going to be in Hidden Figures, which is coming out.
Yeah.
So.
It's funny.
Is he going to be a romance? Because I'm all like that.
Yeah. I don't know. Does he play somebody's husband, or does he?
He's not a husband, but it seems like he is going to be with, from Empires.
Taraji
P. Henson's character.
Yeah.
Like,
guys, if you don't know what Hidden Figures is,
you
need to go see Hidden Figures when it's not out yet, right?
No, not yet.
Yeah, it's
about the women computers, basically.
The three black women who, well, there are more than three, but the story focuses on these three.
Right.
And just their part in NASA.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the other, but it's, he is my pick as well.
Yeah.
Look at you
I had to look up his name. I was like, what's this guy's name? And then you said it. But I first fell in love with him. The first time I ever saw him as an actor was in the 4400. That was on the Sci-Fi
Channel.
That's
what it was, yes.
And he was so good in that role. And, you know, anytime there's an interracial couple, I'm just...
Yeah,
it was such a great. It was sad to see that show end because I loved that relationship, and then they killed her, and it was stupid. But anyway, sorry, spoiler alert. If you haven't seen the 4400, but
you should be aware of that going into
my help alone.
Yeah, but I saw him, and then of course Benjamin Button.
Mm-hmm.
But now he's everything he does. He's another one of those actors. Everything he does, he's just so good.
Yes.
He's so good, and he's so you know, like, I'm so grateful that he's working.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, because he deserves to work.
Right. Yeah.
That was something I was trying to think of how to express what you just said. He's somebody who is a good actor who generally Hollywood probably would not get.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And he's got a hard name to pronounce.
Right.
Come
They're like,
on.
Oh, this foreign guy.
All
right.
He's real dark skinned. I don't know.
Super
how
dark.
Old.
He's got a weird name.
Right.
How did he even get into this country?
Right. That's how it, right. That's exactly, you know, how it is. So I'm so happy to see him getting work, and I know he's just going to keep getting more.
Yeah. I hope so.
On a related note, I just want to shout out to William Lee, who is also, I enjoy in a lot of stuff. He does not get as much play as he should. He plays like this dirtbag informant on Wife, but he's also one of the leads on Falling Water on USA.
Oh.
So,
that sure looks interesting, but too scary for me.
I haven't seen it yet.
I'm just starting to watch it. It's really interesting. So I just want to shout him out because he was in The Wolverine as like one of the like lieutenant bad dudes. Like he always gets like these kind of like low level bad guy parts.
Okay.
But I'm really happy that he's getting some lead stuff now.
I'm real mad that Jimon Hansu is getting older and older while they keep shoving him into those kinds of roles.
Yeah,
I
know.
You wasted that man's talent in Hollywood.
Did. Yeah. He should have been Black Panther in the movie.
Mm.
Oh my god,
that would
have been amazing.
Yeah.
So we are running a little over in time.
Okay.
We had a few more categories, so let's decide which ones we wanted to do out of the ones left. We have comic, music, best con, and best news. Is there one out of those that speaks to you more than the others?
The con. All right, we'll do best con. I will shout out Beyonce and the Dixie Chicks' Daddy Lessons.
Mm-hmm. We both had that as
we
our
both
pick.
Had that as
yeah.
thing, because I also feel like it's a great middle finger to douchebag dudes who don't like women.
You
succeed.
Know, if you're going to do it, I'm not going to be able to stop myself. Yeah. Also, The Weeknd, he is transforming himself as an artist, and I'm really enjoying watching it happen.
And also, I want to shout out Pentatonix, because they are this like a cappella group that was on this, you know, a cappella show on NBC a couple years ago, and they now consistently have like top 10 hits, and they are going to have a musical special on NBC in a little bit. They did a Jolene and Dolly Parton.
Yes.
They are
so good.
Fantastic, just like really great musicians.
And also Tribe Called Quest had an album, and you should go listen to it.
Get
I listened to
track.
It on repeat for like 3 days straight.
Yes.
Aww,
get on that
track.
So yes, we wanted to shout that out.
So apparently we did
music.
Music.
Music. Thing. Yes, music. Do you want to shout any music before we go to the last
Te Vaca. They're amazing, and they did the music, some of the music for Moana, and the best song in Moana is them.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, and then Solange,
Oh, yeah. Solange was
great.
We can't
not mention Beyonce and Solange. They had awesome years.
Right. And then, very quickly to me, the best news of 2016 was Young Justice Season 3.
Yeah. You know what? I could agree to that.
Delights me. All right, so, best geek con.
Look at Tamara being like, fuck you, Sarah. We could do this.
I believe in you. See, like, 45 seconds. It's cool.
So, did we say we wanted to do comics?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, no, con.
Oh,
the
cons.
Comic
best cons.
Cons. Okay.
What's funny is usually I go to a couple of different California ones, but somehow they all ended up at the Los Angeles Convention Center this year. But I'm going to say Stan Lee's Los Angeles Comic Con, the con formerly known as Kamikaze, for a vaguely selfish reason. We had several panels there.
Yay!
That went really nice.
You can watch them on YouTube.
Yeah. And it's, you know, it's a thing, it's a good entryway con for people.
Yes.
People always want to be like, I want to go to San Diego. And I'm like,
no.
Let me caution you to how it is in San Diego.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you go to a slightly smaller one first and see if you can handle that?
Yeah. Or even people conned out by the big con.
Yeah.
It's hard to enjoy Comic-Con.
Yeah,
I agree with you. I cannot agree with you more.
Yeah, because it's too much. I haven't gone to a panel at Comic-Con in probably 4 years. Mm. Like, I'm just working too much outside of it. But, so yeah, so it's a good, like, you know, smaller con is a good starter con for you guys. You can actually, like, go and walk up to the people who are signing and have conversations with them. I took my niece, who is 19 now, and she's on her own volition being a nerd, which is really delightful for me.
So, I love it when they do it on their own.
Yeah, because we are, you know.
So good.
We do what we can.
Yeah, exactly. You know. It's not like we weren't showing her stuff, but Now she's, like, act like she watched all the Harry Potter movies in 1 week. And,
good for her.
And she's into Supernatural, so when we were walking by and Chuck and the trickster were there, and she walked by, and she went, and it was great. It's so cute. So yeah, so we got to talk to a bunch of different people, and you get to like buy stuff, and you get to actually go to panels.
Yeah,
so,
You're not walking like a penguin, yeah. Just trying to get through.
It's just ridiculous these days.
So yeah, and then WonderCon was at LA, the LA Convention Center again this year, which is.
I don't think it will be next year. I think they just announced back in Anaheim. Mm-hmm.
So that will be interesting. So maybe that'll be the one next year.
Hawaii Con on the Big Island was absolutely amazing.
I just
want
to go to that.
It's a small con and it's fantastic. The people who run, I mean, of course, it's in Hawaii. Why don't you want to go to Hawaii?
Right.
Like,
right.
It's on, you know, it's on the Kona side, but it's so good. And just like the aloha there is absolutely amazing. And they have a different theme every year. Like this last theme, they were celebrating Star Trek. And then next year is going to be, I believe, Star Wars. So they're hoping to get some of the Star Wars people, and you know, it's going to be great. But you know, you go to Hawaii and you get to be a geek, and it's just the best of both worlds. Yeah. And if you ever get a chance to go Hawaii Con on the Big Island.
Well, mahalo for that tip. I've been to Hawaii once.
Well, those are my people. Well, I'm from Tahiti, but, you know, the Polynesian people. Yeah. So, awesome. We're all one big ohana.
I'm family.
Yes. As we were Stitch told
us. I actually made, when I was in Hawaii, I made a lot of Hawaiian people happy by the amount of words that I knew. And it was from, like, random places. Like, that was from Lilo and Stitch. And there were just other things. And I also figured out how to defeat an eel if it bites you. Like, they were like, you could become one of us. Just come stay here. And I was like, oh, your spam is so good. Stop tempting me.
Right.
But
spam musubis.
I had to leave. Yeah, luckily, then I ended up moving here in LA where I can get Hawaiian food
all the time.
Yeah, all the time.
It's pretty great. So for me, that event was EVO. For anyone not familiar, EVO is the big video game tournament every year. This year, what made it even more amazing was the main event was held in Mandalay Bay's event center and was filmed for ESPN. And we had an American get pretty far in the top eight. I think it was Street Fighter. I hope I'm not wrong. That would be awkward. I think it was, everyone only cares about Street Fighter. It was Street Fighter. It was Long Island Joe. And his father was in the crowd.
Aww.
And his father looked like the most American. He looked like the father of America.
Oh my
like,
God.
The little cut off sleeves, like wearing a hat, and just looking real proud. And he's like crying at the end because, you know, a grown man is in touch with his fucking feelings. Like, he's just the best
that's
dad.
The best. That's so, the best.
So, like, it was so emotional. He didn't even make it that far. You know, it's kind of a thing that, like, Capcom Cup having an American Grand Finals was a very big deal. Mm. But him making it that far got the whole crowd engaged in hype and USA chants were going around and he was, like, so generous in his loss, and it was just like it was the perfect story, and ESPN ate it up.
Of course they did.
So it was just cool to feel like you were a part of something so big for something that you've been a part of that's been so small for a long time. The FGC is the smallest of the esports, and to see it finally get the kind of recognition I feel such a diverse and awesome community deserves has been amazing. So EVO this year was definitely like the coolest shit ever. Aww. Also, I got a lot of play. Woo! So when you feel cute, it always makes the con feel a little better.
Yeah. And yeah, for San Diego, I dressed in Wonder Woman theme every day, and I enjoyed that. I almost put San Diego that. And I got a lot of hugs by large, burly men.
Of course you did.
Yeah,
I got to hang out with Xavier Woods all of Comic-Con. Aww. It was really hard not to put Comic-Con on there, but the rest of Comic-Con was so shitty.
It was moist and hot.
Oh,
and
right.
Just like,
gross.
It was super gross. But then everybody was really cool and, like, you know, Seamus hugged me when I was after I interviewed him, and aww. I was like, "Oh, you're so large."
That's awesome.
Great,
very nice
white
guy.
Man.
Yes,
shining,
very pale,
shining like a beacon.
Very well dressed man. In the interview.
Well, that always helps.
Did he have
suit.
His little nose ring?
He did have his little nose ring.
Oh.
It looked like it's funny because it kind of became camouflage because he got his hair like down, as opposed to like oh. fanned out, and he was like in a suit, so it just was like it didn't seem as like. Much of a thing.
He didn't seem like a Celtic warrior.
Yeah,
so.
Like he just
oh, yeah.
he was just like, I'm a very dapper Celtic man. Like, that's basically what it was. And I was like, this is a fascinating juxtaposition from what I'm usually used to seeing you.
Wood.
Yeah. So yes.
Xavier Woods was dressed as Garnet.
What?
Oh my. I helped make his afro square.
Oh my god, I love it. I gotta go check out those pictures.
Yes. It's very important. Yeah, I interviewed him too. If you guys go to Loot Crate on YouTube,
yeah,
you can find it.
You can also see her interview with the Benson sisters who write back her own The Girls Who Pray.
Is that on there?
Yeah, oh yeah. I made sure it was.
Oh, I gotta go get it then.
Yeah.
It wasn't on there for a while.
It's on there now, though.
Good.
I made sure of that. Anyway.
Sometimes you gotta crack a whip, guys.
Yeah,
life
every
lesson.
Once in a while. So excellent. That was our 2016 view.
Yay! Yay. 2016 was shitty, but not everything.
But
not everything.
There
yes.
are a lot of big bummers, but there is always bright spots.
Yes.
So thank you so much for coming on the
Yay.
Show.
Thank
Yay.
You for having me.
Tell people anywhere you would like them to follow you or anything you want them to check out.
You can follow me on Twitter at GKBose. Instagram is GKBose. Check out my website, GKBose.com. What else? Yeah, I mean, there's lots of new stuff. Watch
yeah.
Pac-12 networks. Even if you're not a sports fan, you'll like the show. You'll like the stuff on there.
A little bit harder if you don't have DirecTV, but
yeah,
you can find it. You can find the clips.
Yeah,
on,
you can
on
find.
YouTube.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now we ask this every time we have a voice actor on. Would you be willing to say tune into Woman Up in like a voice, a cool voice?
Okay, let me think. Who should I do?
You know, I like Laura and Felicia a lot.
Okay. All right. Laura Matsuda will beat you up if you don't turn into Woman Up.
Sorry, and I have the same reaction every time. It's just so cool. Awesome. Thanks so much.
Yes.
Be sure to tune in to iTunes, allgames.com. Rate us 5 stars if you listen to us on iTunes. If you have a podcast you want us to rate us, we'll do a rate for a rate, motherfuckers. Just give us 5 stars.
Yeah.
If you like us on YouTube, be sure to tell your friends to subscribe because, as you all know, we're going through a little name fight with YouTube because we're too small to really accurately battle. So help us get big enough to say, YouTube, you're being ridiculous. They're like, your name's too long, but you cannot change your name. But also, you need to add one more letter to your name, but it's too long.
What?
Yeah.
It's the most annoying thing. So right now, you actually just have to go into the search and type in Woman Up Podcast to find us, but we do pop right up.
Yes.
And you can follow us at Woman Up Show. You follow me at Sarah the Rebel.
You can follow me at Mrs. Tomorrow on your Twitters and your Instagrams.
And we'll see you next time. But until then, party down and woman up. Bye, guys.